pray for our time together, then we're going to dig right into this. Okay, let me just pray. We're all going to need it, especially me. So let's just pray. That'd be great. Heavenly Father, Lord, we are gathered here now to study your word. Lord, it's been great singing praises to you and just re-experiencing and reminding ourselves of your greatness and the awesomeness of who you are. And Lord, you have also entrusted us with your word. And I ask that you help us to have the wisdom to cut it straight, to interpret it right. Lord, help us to have the focus, to not daydream, to not wander in our imaginations, but instead to really be concentrated upon your word. And with your spirit, help our hearts to be softened, open, receptive to the studying of your word, that we might be convicted, pierced to the core of our being, that we can leave here challenged and even changed, that our desires, our attitudes, our plans, our wishes, our dreams, our goals are more in line with your will. This I pray in your son's name, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, here we are. We're working verse by verse through books of the Bible, and we're in Acts. And we've been in Acts now for like 5 or 6 months. I went through and I actually counted up once, and then I forgot the exact number. We've been in it for a long time. And I knew this was going to be a long study. That's why we're dividing it in half. We're doing the first half of Acts where we're learning about how to rely upon the Spirit. Okay, that's going to be a kind of our focus as we look at Peter and the birth of the church. We're looking at how do we rely upon Jesus and the Holy Spirit to be able to do ministry and life. Then we're going to jolt into the book of Esther. And in Esther, we're going to learn about what it means to live in a religiously diverse environment. We're going to be looking at it from different perspectives. Particularly, we're going to look at a mixed marriage where one of the spouses is a Christian, the other one is not. And we're also going to apply that to being a Christian in a secular work environment, a secular state-governed environment, a secular country, etc., and what that's going to look like. Then we're jolting back to Acts. And we're going to cover the second half. That'll be the life of Paul predominantly through that. And we're going to look at how we engage that pluralistic environment based upon the power of the Holy Spirit for the gospel of Christ. Okay, so we're looking at our relying upon Jesus and the Spirit, looking at a pluralistic environment, and then how do we engage that environment with the gospel? Okay, so that's kind of our trajectory. It's going to take us all the way to the end of the year. Okay, so we're going to be here for a while. And it's been a great ride so far, I think. I've been enjoying it. I can tell you guys have been enjoying it. People have been upset. People have been frustrated, offended, excited, encouraged, challenged, inspired. It's been a roller coaster of a ride. Today will not disappoint. because we're going to deal with some very sensitive, touchy issues, particularly miracles, healings, and revivification or resuscitation or resurrection, however you want to look at those words. And we're going to have to ask some really tough questions. And this is where we find some sharp divides between different Christian groups, like between Baptists and, say, Pentecostals or the apostolic movement and things along those lines. And where do we fall upon that and why and what does this look like? And are both sides potentially wrong? And is there a way to meet in the middle somewhere? Is there a way to be able to try to really get on the same page and worship even together and work together for the kingdom? Because as our country continues on its course, the way it seems to be going, we really need a unification of the churches. We really need that unification. And we can't let differences of different interpretations or understandings of the gifts of the Spirit divide anymore. Okay, we really need to lock arm in arm, and that's going to be awkward and uncomfortable. So we're going to look at, see what Scripture says, figure out where we're at, and try to run from there. Sound good? Okay, so like I said, it's going to be a little rough because we all are coming into this with presuppositions. This is what's going to happen. We all come into that issue that way. And here's the other thing we usually have to recognize, and that is this. There is a tendency within society, and Scripture's no exception to this, to make comparisons. As we start looking at the meat of this, we recognize that people make comparisons. And what this comparison looks like is this. You take an individual, even yourself, and then you liken them, you compare them to someone else, either present or in the past. The goal then is to raise that person up or to discredit them based upon that comparison. That happens a lot in presidential competitions, in presidential election time. We're going to see that coming up as we start looking at who the top candidates are for the GOP and for the Democrats. We're going to see. Like, for example, people might say, look at this individual. They're going to be the Ronald Reagan of the future. Now, depending on your view of Ronald Reagan, whether you liked him or didn't like him, that could be a bonus. You might say, really? They're going to be the next Ronald Reagan? Well, who is this guy? And you might really be interested in them at that point because that comparison raised them up. Or it might be a negative comparison. They might say, well, the last thing we need is another Bush or another Clinton. Especially when you look at Jeb Bush running and Hillary Clinton running, we might hear that comparison quite a bit. Okay, even people might say whoever didn't like the previous Bush administration might say that, or who didn't like the Clinton administration might say that, and we might find that type of comparisons taking place. Back in the early part of the turn of the millennium, there was a movie that came out called Signs. It was directed by M. Night Shyamalan. And after having made movies like The Sixth Sense and Unbreakable and then Signs, people started comparing him. They started saying, look, he is the next Alfred Hitchcock. Now everybody hates him. But nonetheless, for a while, they thought he's going to be the next Alfred Hitchcock. The goal there was to raise him up. Okay, so you have to ask yourself, what comparisons do you make? Because we all do it at some point or another. Maybe they're not quite so intellectual as that. Maybe it's something simple like, well, you know, one day I was walking through Grand Haven and I tripped Chuck Norris. And therefore, I guess that makes me special because I had physical contact with Chuck Norris. I don't know, but people do that. They name drop, right? And by the way, I really did trip Chuck Norris in Grand Haven. I really did. It was great. I tripped this guy. He stumbles. He keeps going. I look. I'm like, was that Chuck Norris? And come to find out, it was. And says he's like the ultimate bad boy. I'm like, I tripped Chuck Norris. All right, and so. Name dropping. People do that. You know, I grew up with John Piper. I guess somehow that makes them a better person because they knew John Piper. But people do that. Even Paul did that. He dropped the name Gamaliel, right? He says, hey, I studied under. Okay, and he name dropped. And you know that's an interesting comparison when somebody name drops, okay, especially Paul. If Paul name drops, that guy's got to be special. Okay, so people make comparisons all the time. So maybe they want to raise somebody up. They might compare them to Mother Teresa or Gandhi, somebody who's greatly respected. They want to tear them down. They might compare them to like Joseph Stalin or maybe Vladimir Putin, or maybe they'll compare them to Mel Gibson. You know, whatever the case may be, they'll work it one way or the other. So if I were to say to you that, hey, we have no longer really DOMs in our Director of Missions anymore within our Southern Baptist Conventions. They've been changed to church catalysts, and these church catalysts are becoming the Joseph Stalins of the SBC. Now, having said that, okay, is that positive? Does that make you feel in favor of, against the idea of church catalysts? Okay, and some of you might be like, now I'm offended. I can't believe you said that about them. They're hardworking people. Now, if I were to say, hey, the church catalysts, they happen to be the Gandhis of the SBC, these wandering wise men of wisdom and grace. Okay, now suddenly people go, wow, who are these church catalysts? I gotta know about them more. You see what that does when you do those comparisons? Okay, it builds up, it tears down, and it can offend, it can excite, it can do whatever. Okay, so that's what those parent comparisons are for, and we do them, and it's okay to do them, it's appropriate, okay? When I say that my brother-in-law throws like a girl, okay, I can know that will have impact, like me getting beaten up in the parking lot after service, okay? I know that will be the case. So those are the things when it comes to comparisons. Now, having said all of that, we're about to go across some events, historically accurate, completely true events in the book of Acts that are going to seem just superb. They're going to seem fantastic, extraordinary, okay? And we have to kind of ask a weird question. Why does Luke, who's recording the book of Acts, record these events versus other events? And the reason is comparison. Luke is trying to build up a parallel between Peter and people in the past to help validate or give higher credibility to what Peter's going to be doing, especially what's going to be coming up later. Okay, so what's happening is Peter's going to be compared to both Jesus as well as compared to Elijah and Elisha, respectively. Okay, so the details are going to be used that are very unique details. Normally, when we see Luke write, he writes, and he writes like a biography or a documentary. Okay, he writes traditionally in chronological order, giving just the facts and moving forward. Every now and then, he will give detail. And that detail is not just because he's anal. It's not because he has OCD. It is because Luke is specifically trying to draw parallels. He wants the reader to see this connection, this comparison between Peter and Jesus and Elijah and Elisha. And I don't know about you, but those are great people to be compared to. Okay, those are great people to be compared to. So we're going to see that kind of filter out. So like, for example, just so you can see this when we go through it, Peter's going to heal going to heal somebody who's paralyzed. My tongue got wrapped around my eye teeth. I couldn't see what I was saying. Okay, so so he's going to heal somebody who's paralyzed, and then he's going to raise a woman from the dead. And that is going to be worded in such a way to compare to Jesus when he healed someone who was paralyzed, when they lowered him on a mat from the ceiling, and when he went just a couple chapters later and raised Jairus' daughter from the dead. And we're going to find certain details that will actually directly point to and parallel those events. So Luke describes them intentionally the same. And it's great to see that when you go to Luke's account of those events and then the account of Peter's events and find the exact same vocabulary, the exact same syntax and sentence structure and details and examples, and we find that. And then he'll throw in a little other details, and those other details are the exact wording from Elijah and Elisha. And again, very intentional drawing those parallels because Luke wants to raise Peter up. He wants to prepare the audience for Peter. Because what's about to happen next time we meet? Peter's going to have a vision that's going to change the dietary code forever. And if the Jews are going to receive that, they need to know that Peter's a man of God. They need to know that Peter is not a false Messiah or a false prophet. They need to know that Peter is trustworthy. And so Luke is doing everything he can, guided by the Spirit, to write this out in a way that everyone goes, Peter, we trust him. He's a man of God. Peter said, what? Well, if I disagree with that, then I'm in the error because I can't go against Peter because Peter's a man of God. You see how that comparison is going to be built up like that. Okay, so that's what we're going to be seeing. So it starts off here in chapter 9. This is going to conclude the chapter for us. First part of it is Peter and Aeneas. Okay, so Aeneas is he's a paralyzed man. I'm going to have to sit down before I hurt myself. Okay, so he's a paralyzed man. And so Peter's going to be working with this. We're going to read the verses 33 to 35. Then we're going to talk about it briefly. Then we'll hit the issue of Dorcas or Tabitha. I'm telling you, don't name your daughter Tabitha. Just telling you that right now. We'll see why later. It's just not worth it. So starting at verse 33 in chapter 9, backing up just a little bit just to give the story and context. As Peter was traveling from place to place, he also came down to the saints who lived in Lydda. There he found a man named Aeneas who was paralyzed and had been bedridden for 8 years. Notice this. He was not born paralyzed. In some cases, we have people who are born that way. In some cases, we have people who are not. This is one of the cases where it is not. So he became paralyzed either because of illness, like tuberculosis attacking the spinal cord, resulting in paralysis, or maybe he had a stroke, or maybe it's not illness related at all. He had an accident, fell off of a roof, and ended up breaking his back, resulting in paralysis at that point. Whatever the case may be, he is now paralyzed and has been bedridden for 8 years. Put yourself there for a moment. Not being able to get out of bed. Not being able to move because you are paralyzed. Okay, just put yourself there. I know for most of us, we'd be like, well, that's fine. I got my cable TV. I got my cell phone. I got my smartphone. I got a computer. I got the internet. I can call someone. And they didn't have that. Okay, Verizon wasn't moved into that area yet. UVerse hadn't quite installed the cables yet. They're still digging stuff up. Okay, so there's no cable, no internet, no contact. You can't get anywhere. There's no disability service. There's no SSI. There's no food stamps. So you're not getting income from anything. He's not going to be able to support a family. He's not going to be able to attract a woman if you can't move and go anywhere. You see, he's just in a place of complete desperation. So I just want you to sense this hopelessness, okay? Sense this hopelessness. I think sometimes we see the people on the side of streets with homeless signs, and we see people in different places of desperation, and we want to immediately jump at it with a skeptical eye, and we don't stop and ask, are they really in a desperate place? And what is that like for them? And what would the love of Jesus look like for them? Okay, so here's this guy, and he's been paralyzed, bedridden, hadn't been able to get out of his bed for how long?
8 years.
Okay, 8 years. Long time. Long time. Everybody around him knows of him. Maybe he has friends who picks him up and drops him off somewhere, like a paralyzed man had back in the beginning of the church when the apostles were going to the temple and they saw a paralyzed man who friends would just kind of drop him off so he could ask for alms, right? He was paralyzed from the legs, from the waist down. So maybe he had friends like that, and maybe not. Maybe he was completely in his same bed, same spot the whole time with somebody having to bring him food. Who knows what this was completely like for him, but it's a desperate situation. So Peter comes across this man, and Peter, verse 34, says to him, Aeneas, Jesus Christ heals you. Who heals him? Jesus Christ. This is important. This is important. While Peter obviously has the gift, and Peter has been gifted in this type of a manner, he is still pointing to the author of miracles. And that's Jesus Christ. That's kind of important. Okay, so Jesus Christ heals you. Get up and make your bed. Ladies, if you ever want a verse to be able to cite to your husband to make your bed, here's your verse. You're welcome. Okay. If you want a verse to give to your kids, make your bed. Well, yeah, well, God doesn't say so. Actually, I'm glad you said that. Let's look at Acts chapter 9. Here it says, make your bed. Okay, so this is kind of neat. Get up and make your bed. The actual reading of this is, take up your mat. That's the actual reading of this. Now, the Holman translation here kind of fleshes it out because it has this idea of making your bed. In fact, take up your mat literally means make your bed, but technically that is roll it up and take it. Okay, because bed wasn't like it was today where you have pillows and a blanket and a sheet and a little fitted sheet underneath that and a comforter and something you plug into the wall to make it extra warm on those cold nights. Okay, it wasn't like that. It was literally, here's a piece of cloth, sometimes even a tunic that you could wear, sometimes like a hooded type of deal, depending on how you folded it, and you would just roll it up and carry it with you. When it's time to go to bed, you just, and down you go. Okay, so it's take up your mat, make your bed. Who else said that to a paralyzed man? Jesus did. When he was lowered in from the ceiling, and Jesus looks at him, and Jesus says, "You know, your sins are forgiven." And then everyone's all freaked out. Your sins are forgiven. Who can do this? Well, what would you be even more impressed if I said even this? And he said, "Take up your mat and walk." And so the guy took up his mat, made his bed, and walked. Okay, so very similar, very exact phrasing here. Make your bed. Take up your mat. Okay, so take up your mat. And immediately he got up. So all who lived in Lydda and Sharon saw him, and they, what? Turned to the Lord. Okay, and they turned to the Lord. If you're one who writes in your Bible or highlights, that's a good phrase to kind of keep noted. Okay, and so all who saw him, not Peter, all who saw this paralyzed guy, turned to the Lord. Okay, so here's what's going on. We got this sickness in verse 33. Like we said, we don't know if it's illness related or what's going on. So we have some type of infirmity, if you will, some type of disability there. We have the healing that takes place. Notice it's instantaneous and immediate. It's not processed over a period of time. It's not he's getting well. It's immediate. And it's interesting as he got up and he walked, which means how weak would his legs have been? Okay, have you ever sat down so long that your legs fell asleep? And then you try to walk and you look like a drunk deer? Right, you're kind of like, oh! You know, have you ever had that? And you're just, your legs feel, and you don't want to put weight on it, right? Because if you put weight on it, it just sends tingles all the way up. You're like, right? Okay, he got up and he just walked after 8 years of not walking. All that muscle deterioration restored. Okay, this is just amazing. It's not like he forgot how to walk and relearned. It's there. The knowledge of the balance is there. The muscle strength is there. It's complete healing immediately. Okay, not in process over a period of time. And he didn't need a credit card to do it. And he didn't need a white hanky. He didn't need to have something mailed to him. He was just, it was complete and it was absolutely immediate. And then the result's the key here. The goal was not predominantly this man's healing per se. The goal and the focus is on the result. And the result is many people got saved. Okay, that's the result. Many people got saved. This is just, I cannot stress the importance of that. You'll see why in just a little bit. We're going to see all this piece together. Many people got saved. Now, after dealing with Aeneas, just moving on with the text, and we'll recap all of this as one big sum here in just a moment, we find Peter and Tabitha, also called Dorcas, okay, because they really are the same name, and it means deer. And in case you're wondering, it looks like that the word dork, ever been called the dork? Comes from the idea of drunk deer. Okay? Because deer would eat fermented apples or fermented fruit that falls off the tree and they stay on the ground for a long period of time, they ferment. And when deer eat those, they get intoxicated. I kid you not, this is a fun video to watch, and they start doing this. Okay, they do, and they run, and they'll fall over on their side and kick their legs in the air, and they'll roll back up, and they'll bang into trees, and they act like a dork. Okay, so it's so Tabitha means deer, means Dorcas, which means deer, and then the short of that slang insult term, comes from the idea of drunk deer. That's one of the theories behind that. It's not like guaranteed in stone, but it looks like where that term comes from. Isn't that kind of nice to know? Little piece of trivia for you. Isn't that fun? And so that's why I'm like, don't necessarily name your daughters Tabitha. If you have somebody named Tabitha, God bless them, man, because if somebody finds this out, they're not hearing the end of it. I'm telling you that right now. Okay, it's just not happening. My aunt named one of her daughters Mariah. And when you take the I and you pronounce it in the Greek type slang, it pronounces Maria, which means moron. And so I told that to her sister. Because I'm just that kind. It's just, you know, I love educated jokes. I think they're great, and they're totally ignored in society a lot. So use it when you come across it. Doggone it. So Peter meets this Tabitha, meets this girl, okay, meets this lady. So here's how this reads from verse 36 right to the end of chapter 9. This will we'll have our conclusion of with this part of the text. Then we'll hit chapter 10 next time we meet. It says this in verse 36, in Joppa, now in another city, okay, so we were in, we were in like the Jenison area. Now we're going to go to like God's country, which would be, you know, Grand Rapids, right? And so now they're moving to a different city. So in Joppa, there was a disciple named Tabitha, which was translated Dorcas. She was always doing good works. Okay, fascinating. Luke gives us this type of detail about this woman. People say that the Bible is like anti-women and is misogynist and all these things. And yet we see women praised all the time and pointed out all the time and elevated all the time. And all people want to do is just try to slam off how God had brought out order and structure. And that's the way it's supposed to be because it's based off of the Trinity. And so when you look at submission issues that are supposed to be taking place, it's like, hey, women, you're compared to both Jesus and the Holy Spirit who are submissive to the Father. And that's not bad comparisons. Those are worthy comparisons to be called a helper, like the Holy Spirit's the helper. And we got a whole book about how to rely on the Holy Spirit here in dealing with Jesus. So this is just an awesome, awesome comparison there. So there's this woman, and she's just was an amazing godly woman. Amazing godly woman. We'll see how in just a little bit. But she was doing good works and acts of charity. Okay, so acts of charity. She loved giving to people. She loves giving to people. And specifically what? We'll see in just a few verses. In those days, she became sick and she died. Okay, this is Luke writing this. This is Luke who is able to do this research. He's a medical doctor. If he's going to be able to say somebody died, somebody died. Okay, just kind of pointing that out. So, and she died. After washing her, they placed her in a room upstairs. Okay, so they're kind of getting things ready for burial, and they're going to have their big mourning service upstairs. So since Lydda was near Joppa, like Jenison to Grand Rapids, not that far away, Okay, since Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples heard that Peter was there, and they sent two men to him who begged him, "Don't delay in coming with us." So Peter got up and they went with them. This is interesting that they went to Peter. This is interesting that they sent for Peter. They sent for anyone at all. When someone dies, what do? You sent for family members, you have a funeral service, and you put them in the ground and you're done. It seems like they're wanting something more than just pastorally comfort here. It seems like they're wanting more than just a good sermon and some compassion and someone to pray with them. It seems like they heard that Peter is unique, that Peter is special, that God is using him in the marvelous, marvelous ways. Maybe Wynn has even gotten word about this paralyzed man, and that they heard that that had happened, and they're just shooting like a Hail Mary for a miracle. They're just taking that football, and they're just throwing, and they're just hoping it lands in someone's hands appropriately. Okay, it might be what's going on. So Peter got up, and he went with them. When he arrived, they led him to the room upstairs, and all the widows approaching him, weeping and showing him the robes and clothes that Dorcas had made while she was with them. This is the type of woman she was. She was a knitter. She was a seamstress. And she was the type of woman who would make something and then give it to people. She's the type of person. Maybe you know someone like this. You can't go to their house without receiving something. Right? You're leaving with something from them when you visit them. You might be leaving with a shirt they made, with a scarf they made, or a washcloth, or maybe they baked you a pie. Maybe they, you know, whatever it is, they made you something, and you're leaving with something in your hands. Maybe they just said, "Hey, I don't need this anymore. I would love for you to have it," and they're just giving stuff. That's this Tabitha, wonderfully charitable woman, wonderful, wonderful, godly woman. Okay, and so she was the type that would knit things, make things, have things, and give it. Just constantly giving stuff. Okay, so they're weeping, they're crying, and they're showing Peter, this is this woman. Look at what this woman was like. She was this great, charitable woman. She was a giver. She was absolutely a giver. Almost as if to say, it's not fair, she's dead. Almost as if to say, look at all the ministry now that's going to cease because this woman's gone. All the lives that she keeps touching are now not going to be touched because she died and didn't die because she was old. She didn't die because it was like her, in a sense, lifespan time had come to a close. She died because of what? She got sick. Okay, so a lot of times people look, if you die from old age, people say you lived a long life. When they die from a car accident or they die from an illness, people say, man, they left us too soon. They left us too soon. And you could be all pious you want. Rich Mullins was like that one time. He said, left you too soon. You can't believe he died so young. I'm surprised you got to live to be so old. Even you talk about an 18-year-old who was killed. He said, I'm surprised he got to live to be so old because of sin and judgment. None of us deserve life at all. And while true as that is, that has like the black belt level of compassion. Okay, that's black belt compassion there. That's not good compassion there. And so that's how people are. Okay, if one of my children were to die, I would be like, man, this is too soon. You tell me that because of sin that they shouldn't have lived to be 4 or 10 or whatever, I'm going to kick you. I'm going to kick you hard, okay? It's not going to be helpful because for me, it would be too soon. For me, it would be, even if my mom, who's lived a long life, who's... Okay, who lived a long life, if she were to get sick and die, I would say it was too soon. I would say it was too soon. Now, if she hits old age and her body just gives out, that's a different issue. It's a different issue. Okay, so there's something about illness or something that just pulls at our heart at a different way. It just does. It becomes unexpected. The grief tends to be just a little bit different. It's not deeper. It's not harder. It's just different, and it's different in a different way. And we just have to respect that. So here they are, they're grieving. Because to them, her departure was too soon. To them, she was a pillar of ministry in the city and in the community. To them, she had extraordinary value, and all they wanted was her back. And if anyone ever could possibly do anything, it would be Peter. It'd be Peter. So they send out to him, and he's there. Okay, so they're weeping, and they're showing him all the things of who she was. You know, it's interesting. Could you be described by the possessions in your home? And if you could, what would it say? So here she is being described by the possessions in her home. And so here's what happened. So then Peter sent them all out of the room. He's like, everybody out of here. I don't know if it was like a chicken coop where all the ladies, I've seen ladies do this, where they're all talking at the same time and somehow they understand each other. I don't get it, but they do. They go, blah, 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 right? In fact, the Music Man play made fun of that with the song, pick a little, talk a little, pick a little, talk a little, cheep, 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 talk a little, pick a little more. And I was in the play, I know it. So in case you're wondering how I pulled that out of somewhere. Okay, and so that's how women are. And I watch them go to the bathroom at the mall. I watch these like a whole group of like 8 or 10 teenagers going to the bathroom going blah, 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 blah. You know how men go to the bathroom? Single file, quiet, no one talking to anyone. You go in by the women's bathroom, you hear blah, 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 blah. You go to the men's bathroom and it's silent the way it should be. Okay? No one's talking to me when I'm in the stall and it should be that way. But not so in the women's bathroom. Not so. Okay? And so they're just going off. So maybe it was like that for Peter. This lady's talking to him, this lady's talking to him, this lady's talking to him, and he's like, everybody out! Everybody out. Or he wanted some solitude because he didn't want to embarrass the name of God. Because he might be trying to tell her, rise and walk, and maybe it won't happen. And if it doesn't happen, that's okay. God could choose not to intervene that way. Maybe that's what's going on. Who knows? Or Luke is showing us that this happened, and we don't know the motivation for Peter doing this. Just know that he did it, and that parallels, compares to three people who did isolated resurrections or resuscitations. That is Jesus, Elisha, and Elijah. All three of them did that. When Jesus went to raise Jairus' daughter, he kicked everybody out of the room. And the wording on Jesus doing that is exactly related to Elijah and Elisha, who did the exact same thing when they raised people from the dead in 1 Kings chapter 17 and 2 Kings chapter 4, where Elijah in 1 Kings said, everybody out and raise someone from the dead, and Elisha in 2 Kings 4 said, everybody out and raise somebody from the dead. And then Jesus shows up and says, everybody out, and raises Jairus' daughter from the dead. Now Peter shows up and says, everybody out. Everybody out. And if these widows knew their Bible and knew history, knew the Old Testament, knew the Torah, knew the stories of Elijah and Elisha, had heard winds of Jesus, if they knew, okay, because likely at this point, circulations have already existed of Matthew and Mark. Okay, so if those are really circulating like that, like we believe that they were, they might have even heard stories of Jesus and Jairus' daughter. And so, therefore, they might be hearing Peter saying, everybody out, and they go, oh, everybody out, something good is about to happen. And all the weeping stopped, and everything stopped, and everybody's outside, just, Peter's about to do something cool. You know, maybe that's going on, I don't know, but he kicks everybody out. Okay, so he absolutely kicks everybody out. And he knelt down. It's interesting that he kneels down. Yes, you can pray standing up. When you're praying in your car, keep your eyes open if you're driving. Okay. Yes, God does not see certain postures as more reverent than other postures like that. He's not like if you lay on the ground like Martin Luther used to, nose to the ground in the shape of a cross, that God will hear your prayers better because you took that pose. It's not the case. God promises to hear all prayers and everyone. He hears us. He's guaranteed to hear us. Even if we don't feel like he's hearing us, he does. Okay, so but it's neat to see every now and then the reverency of a posture. It's neat to see every now and then the respect that is given. Not because this posture made what's about to happen effective. It's not because of the posture. It's the attitude of the apostle. I want you to notice. It's his attitude. That God's holiness is of such greatness that every now and then it's worth kneeling before him. Every now and then it's worth taking that posture of reverence and respect. Okay, so Peter kneels down, he prays, and he turns. Who knows what he prayed? I'm glad that it didn't get recorded. Otherwise, everyone would treat it like a mechanic. They say, well, if you say these words in this way, then this will happen, and they'll treat it cause and effect. Okay, so I'm glad that we don't have that detail of what he prayed. So he prayed, then he turns toward the body and says, dork, arise. Tabitha, get up. She opened her eyes, saw Peter, and sat up. He gave her his hand and helped her stand up. Then he called the saints and widows and presented her alive. This became known, you think, throughout Joppa. And what's the result? And many believed in the Lord. Many people got saved. And Peter stayed on many days in Joppa with Simon, a leather tanner, somebody who works on dealing with stripping the hide from an animal and then tanning it, which is getting it ready to be molded into clothing or any type of things like that. So he's tanning the leather. Not a greatly respected profession. So it's nice that Peter went and stayed with somebody who basically was a fry cooker for Burger King. Kind of nice. So this is this interesting development here of Peter and Tabitha, where we see that she was a woman of a godly woman, a woman of charity, and that she died. There was preparation. There was requesting of Peter. He shows up, and then we hear about how she would give specifically of her items, and then she was raised from the dead. Okay, so we see this nice little development that had taken place here. Now, this leads us to a very interesting and troubling question. Very interesting and troubling question. One that you might never have thought to ask. And this goes something like this. Why did Peter raise Tabitha and not Stephen? Think about that. Peter was in Jerusalem area when Stephen was stoned. Stephen was a godly man, a leader in the church, a charitable man, a man who preached boldly, a man with great wisdom that was able to confound the Jews to the point that a leader of the Pharisees named Saul would actually orchestrate an execution. Okay, so why did the people not come and grab Peter and say, hey, Peter, come here into this burial area and let's raise Stephen so that the gospel can continue? No one even requested. And yet this happens with Tabitha. I don't know about you, but if Stephen's parents were alive and they heard about Tabitha, wouldn't you feel a little gypped? Wouldn't you feel a little offended that Peter, who was there with Stephen, did not intervene, but does with Tabitha? Why is it that God chose to act with one and not the other? And to begin to try to unpack that difficult question, we're going to have to unpack other issues regarding miracles and regarding healing in itself, and asking ourselves, why is it that God did this in the past? Does he do it in the present? What does that mean if he does? What does this look like? And if he doesn't, why not? If he does, then why? Do we not see it more often than we should? And on, the questions can end up going. We had covered similar issues to this in the past when the first healing had taken place in Acts. I'd like to refer you to our YouTube channel for that, to see that discussion regarding the spiritual gifts and the miraculous gifts themselves. What I would like to look at today is specifically God's intervention in a miraculous way. Why it is that God intervenes here but not there, why it seems that he hasn't intervened or won't intervene, why it seems that his intervention doesn't look like the way we would expect it to look like, and try to begin to piece some of that together, and then from that, go back to Stephen and Tabitha and try to answer this question that we have right here. Okay, so that's what I'd like to try to do for us and what this is going to mean. And because of the time that we have available, I know we got like 2 hours left. And so, I'm just kidding. Because of the limited time, all I can really begin to do on this is starting to kind of scratch the surface here. But I do want to give you some depth with application on this. So bear with me as we go through this. I'm going to go a little quick in spots. If ever you end up finding that, man, I want more on that, I'd love to talk about this more, grab me at the end of the service. Go on Facebook and message me. Pick up the phone, text me, call me, email me, whatever, and I'd be willing to be able to open up an online dialogue or meet you somewhere. I have no problem going to like a Big B and getting a smoothie. That'd be great. Starbucks has horrible smoothies, so don't take me to Starbucks. I'm not going to take you there. But Big B, they got pretty good smoothies. I can work with them. And so we'll go there. Whatever the case may be, we can hash this out even further if you'd like. So I'd like to try to look at some myths about miracles. I think this is going to be a great way to try to surface hop this a little bit and look at the myths about miracles, particularly healing. Because that's the one that tends to get the most debate amongst Christian groups and the most divisions amongst congregations and denominations. Okay, so there are some myths that exist. I'd like to just flesh these myths out real quick for you. The first myth is this. When you see these statements, they're not true. These statements you're about to see are not true. They are the myth statement, okay? I want to emphasize that lest you say, I saw it on the board, he said it. It's a myth that's not true. And the first one is this, that only God heals. Okay, that only God heals. Keep in mind, God is the creator. He is the omnipotent. He is the all-powerful. There is also another individual who is not omnipotent, not all-powerful, is not the creator, but is still supernaturally powerful. And that is Satan, a.k.a. the devil, who has abilities to do amazing things. Like, for example, Paul himself writes for us in, Jesus himself said this in Matthew 24:24, said that false Christ and false prophets will arise and perform many signs and wonders. This is from Jesus himself saying that the false prophets will arise and they will perform many signs and wonders. The exact same phrase given to describe miracles and healings by Paul in 2 Corinthians regarding the signs of an apostle. Okay, so therefore we know that there are false messiahs, false Christ, false prophets that will have power to do miracles. And Jesus goes on to even say that they will be so convincing they could almost even persuade the strong Christians or persuade the elect. Okay, when Moses went to go deliver the Israelites and he did signs and wonders of many things, what did the Egyptian sorcerers, what were they able to do on many occasions? They were able to do miracles and signs and wonders too. They couldn't make it go away. But they could make it worse. And by the way, that's what Satan usually does. He makes things worse. He doesn't usually make things go away. But here's the thing. Because Satan can do miracles and demons can do miracles and those involved in the occult have the potential of doing miracles, that means then that not every miracle only comes from God. God is not the only one who does miracles in this world. And we have to recognize that. And so there are many people that think that, hey, so-and-so is healed. Clearly, God's involved. Not necessarily. Not necessarily. Because Satan also has the ability to do miraculous things. Okay, so we kind of have to keep that in mind. Another myth that really needs to be fleshed out a little bit is that God always intervenes. That God always heals. That as long as if he doesn't, it's because it's your fault. You didn't have faith. Or the person who's sick didn't have faith. Or whatever the case may be. Okay, so there's this myth that says that God always intervenes. And here's the issue. God has healed in the past. Absolutely true. God will one day heal it all on the new earth. This side of eternity, this side of that everlasting issue, this side of the new earth, this side of the glimpses of God's kingdom being present in part but not in full in this stage of issues. Okay, another way of looking at it is in between the trees, in between the tree of Genesis and the tree that's in Revelation, the tree of life being in both, and our life exists in between those trees, here in this area, God does not always intervene. Okay, and here's kind of how this begins to play out a little bit. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 20, Paul himself said that he left Trophimus, who was ill at Miletus. So there was a disciple, a godly man, who was ill. Paul did not heal him. Paul has healed many people. did not heal him, left him sick at the city to be tended to. And then Paul left. Interesting. God did not intervene. Paul himself had a thorn in his side. Right? Paul himself said in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 7 through 9, he said, I have a thorn in my side, whatever that is. Okay, I have a thorn in my side. I have this problem, and I would like it removed. Interesting, the healer could not heal himself because it did not happen. He prayed repeatedly. So let me ask this then. Is Paul a godly man? Would you say Paul was a guy who had a weak faith? No. If anyone had strong faith, it was Paul. Okay, he was the lion of faith when you look at Scripture. Unlike Peter, who was, you know, weak at first and became strong, Paul seemed to just start running. He hit the ground running and was strong all the way across. Didn't understand the Jesus issue, but when Jesus found out, that same fervor and faith and passion that guided his life before guided his life after. Okay, so Paul was an amazing faith-filled man. Strong man, lion of history, really is. Amazing man. He had faith. Did he pray to ask God to remove his thorn? Yes. In fact, he says three times. And that's not necessarily meaning only three and he quit. It almost has this idea that Paul loves triplicates and loves that perfection of three. So it's almost like he said repeatedly, 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 like holy, 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 as much as you could ever imagine the completion of praying that God would remove this from me. And God repeatedly said no. And who traveled with Paul a lot? Luke, which means that medicine did not help, miracle did not happen. All that God did was maintain the current course of action. That's what God did. It wasn't medicine, it wasn't miracle, it was maintain. Because sometimes God will intervene and allow medicine to be effective. Sometimes medicine is not effective. Some diseases don't have a cure. Some diseases have a 50% success rate. Some surgery procedures have a high success rate. Some have a low success rate. God allows sometimes medicine to be very effective, but not always. Not always is it effective. Sometimes miracles happen, and stuff happens that confound science. And doctors go, this shouldn't have happened. This makes absolutely no sense. We can't understand this. So sometimes there's medicine. Sometimes there's miracle. Sometimes it's about maintenance. And God simply maintains the current course of action. He just says, this is where it's been. This is where it's going. No, I'm not intervening. In fact, God ends up telling Paul, you know what? You're going to suffer this for the rest of your life so that my grace can be made perfect in your weakness. So that through your weakness, you will see the strength of God. That's what Paul ends up sharing for us in 2 Corinthians there. Okay, so that's what we find is sometimes God intervenes and people are made well, and sometimes they aren't. And miracles don't happen. Okay, so this idea that God always intervenes, no. No. In fact, it's a rare thing. It's a rare thing like that. It really is. When you look at all the people and all the history of that Scripture covers, and you look at just the ones that were really involved in being healed or what made it into Scripture, and it's really not a large percentage of the population that had issues and infirmities or disabilities or diseases or even death. A lot of people died. Was Stephen raised again? No, he was not. Okay, so God does not always intervene. Another way of looking at it is we're all going to die of something someday. Okay, so there's going to be a point where God will not intervene with you. That will happen. Okay, so God always intervenes is a myth. And then the last myth is this, that God never intervenes. It's the other myth. That God never intervenes. This is where I'm going to make some of the staunch, really diehard Baptists mad. Okay, I already made those who are going to be watching this online, and we get quite a few online views here and there, especially on Facebook, you know, up to a couple hundred sometimes. And so the number two will probably tick off the Pentecostals. I'll get hate mails later. Number three is going to upset some of the Baptists, so I expect the Baptist State Convention of Michigan contacting me saying, we need to have a little bit of a sit-down chat review. The other myth is that God never intervenes. And a way of looking at this, let me just give you logic here, okay? Let me just give you some logic. Here we go. Peter is before the paralyzed man and before Tabitha. And he said, who is it that healed? Jesus. Who is it that's responsible for Tabitha coming up from the dead? Jesus. Okay, so Jesus is responsible. Was Jesus physically walking on the earth present, or had he already ascended into heaven? Already ascended to heaven. So Jesus was not present. And yet Jesus was both active, available during these times. Is Jesus changed that issue today? He has not. He is still in heaven at the right hand of the Father. Is he still active and available in the world today? Because let me tell you about a miracle that is taking place on a daily basis that we tend not to realize as being a miracle, but it is, and it's called salvation. It is where you have an enemy of God who wants nothing to do with God, and not on anything they could do on their own volition, the Holy Spirit starts intersecting their life, intervening in their life in advance so that their heart becomes changed, not because of anything they did, but because of something the Holy Spirit is doing, so that the enemy of God can one day become soft and responsive to where they will say, I want new desires, new goals, new plans, new attitude, new lifestyle, and instead of living for my own kingdom, I'm living for God's kingdom. And they say, Lord, not my will, but your will be done. And they ask for forgiveness of their sin. And this enemy of God becomes a child of God. Miracle. And it's happening every day on the face of this planet. Jesus and the Holy Spirit are intervening in the lives of people every day across this entire planet. So Jesus is very active and available. Yeah? Very active and available. So if he was active and available in Acts, and he's active and available today, does that mean that there can still be an intervention? Yes. Yes, there can still be an intervention. Things can happen, and that frustrates people. And it frustrates Baptists, because that means that the future is unpredictable. It means that we can't have a clear-cut science on what is and is not God working. We're really going to have to work it through. Because if a miracle happens, now we have to ask the question, is this God or Satan? Because not all miracles are from God. And if God's intervening, why is he intervening? What does this mean and what's happening as a result? And it means we got a lot of work to do. It means that life isn't easy, but it's not boring. Okay, so we kind of have to keep in mind that God can indeed intervene. Sometimes that intervention is medicine. Sometimes that intervention is miracle. Sometimes his intervention is maintenance, where he maintains the status quo. I have asked repeatedly to not have to wear glasses, and God says, why? You look so sexy. It's just an ego boost. I can't argue with that. So I'm like, okay, you're right, God. Thank you. He speaks through the mouth of my wife, so it's great to know that she's a channel of that for me. Okay, and so, you know, but and I've had a rough, my tooth will hurt so bad, and it needs a root canal. I've had several root canals, and I'll be like, God, please just make my tooth go away, and God says, cool, not a problem. Go see this person over here. They're going to numb you up, and you will have no pain. Okay, medicine. And there have been times where people's cancer has gone into remission and science goes, we don't understand. And then it comes back. And then the people get frustrated. Why did God make it go away here, but now it's back? What's going on? Why is God making it? And then we get these really difficult questions, very much like the issue with Stephen and Tabitha. Why here and not there? See where all this begins to tie in. Okay, why here and not there? So let's try to unpack that part a little bit. And first, I'd like to be able to state a general rule of thumb for you that should garner everything that you think about God, and that is this. First off, allow God to be God. Okay, allow God to be God. He does what he does because he has the right to do it. And we really cannot see the whole picture. And sometimes we'll never see the whole picture. Even when we get to the new earth, and we'll maybe we'll say, I want to ask God why he allowed. And when we get there, we'll probably be like, who cares? You know, and God, because in reality, when you look at Job and his suffering, would God telling him, by the way, because God never told Job why. Because if God had told Job, hey, you suffered, you lost your kids, all this happened because, you know, you were helping me win a bet. My cards were on the table, and we were playing poker with Satan, and I wanted to win. And Job, you were my ace in my sleeve, so thank you for that. You know, would that really help Job? Would that be comforting to him? No, not a bit. So sometimes the big picture is not comforting, and God withholds the big picture. We're not going to understand why the answer was yes or no. Sometimes that picture is amazing, and it means that because of something that happened here, the peace has fallen away, that lots of people get saved over there, and you're just not going to see that. Sometimes it's an amazing picture. Sometimes the picture is just we don't understand it, and it seems weird from our point of view. And so we just don't see all of it. So we kind of have to allow God to be God. So allow me to offer how this works to be this. What is your goal when you ask God to intervene? Is your goal healing, or is your goal the glory of Jesus? For most people that I've talked to, their goal is healing. Their goal is not the glory of Jesus. And here's what happens. If your goal is healing, if your goal is intervention, and you pray and say, God, intervene, and God chooses to say no, what people tend to do is they shake their faith. Sometimes they'll even seek alternate routes of other religions. And they'll say, well, I tried Christianity once. It didn't work for me. I've heard that phrase a dozen times. Okay, because the goal was God actually ends up being a means to an end. I was using God to get me somewhere. So is your goal healing? Is your goal that intervention? Or is your goal the glory of Jesus? And if it's the glory of Jesus, then if he heals you, then Jesus gets the glory. If God says, no, I'm not going to heal you, I'm going to maintain you, and God still gets the glory. So what's your goal? The glory of Jesus or the intervention? And that answer to that question will determine whether you're able to do allowing God to be God. Okay, so that's just that beginning surface thing there. Now I'd like to get to some specifics on that. Why does God sometimes intervene? I'd like to give you a kind of a systematic theology approach to this a little bit. Just hit a few areas of Scripture, a few categories, if you will, of why God sometimes intervenes. Looking at God's interventions and categorizing them into grouping so that we can try to make sense of this. Then we can go to Tabitha, we can go to Stephen, we can draw a conclusion based on these four categories, figure out how to allow God to be God, and we'll be done for the day. Sound good? So we're almost done, so bear with it. See, that's just a little pastoral homiletic to kind of get you reawakened again. It's when we say, in conclusion, and we can go another half hour because I know I got you for a good 15, 20 minutes. So in conclusion will be these 4 points, followed by an overview. So the categories are, and I will go through these relatively quickly, okay? And I have on your fill-in-the-blank sheets the verses for these. I'm going to give you the categories that go with those verses. So first one, John 9:3, the category from that is, for his glory. Why was it that this man is blind? And Jesus said, this man was born blind, not because of his sin, not because of his parents' sin, but so that people can see the glory of God. So they can see the power of God at work. Okay, so for one reason would be that God will intervene because that is what is going to elevate people understanding his glory. Okay, so it's for his glory. The second category is from Acts 3, verses 1 through 10, and that is to lead the lost to Jesus. Now, what were those two phrases that we saw happening in both Aeneas' and Tabitha's story? As a result of the paralyzed guy getting healed, and as a result of Tabitha coming to life again, how did those stories both end? And many believed in the Lord that day. And that word belief is not just I agree with a set of facts. That belief is I believe in the way that changes everything about me. It's not just knowledge I've grabbed a hold of. It's knowledge that has turned around and grabbed a hold of me, and I'm a different person because of it. It's a nice way of saying a lot of people got saved. Okay, it's a nice way of saying that. And so a lot of people believed in God that day. They lost people, came to Jesus. That's what was going on in both of those categories. Okay, now you might be able to argue, what about Stephen? If Stephen was still alive, he was preaching, a lot of people might have come to Jesus with Stephen too. Although it's interesting that in all of Stephen's preaching, never once is it recorded that people came to accept Jesus as Savior because of Stephen's ministry. That's interesting. Does that mean if you're ineffective that you will never have intervention? Does that go right back to that faith issue again, that God always intervenes as long as on you? No. There's something else going on. That's the teaser going on to Category 3. Just gotta whet your appetite for this here. Category number 3, based off of Acts chapter 2, based off of 2 Corinthians chapter 12, to validate the prophets and the apostles. It says in 2 Corinthians 12:12 that the signs of an apostle were performed among you so that you'd know that they were apostles. Okay, you know who the apostles are based upon the signs that they did, based upon this amazing power that they seem to be able to perform. Okay, so sometimes God will intervene so that his people are validated, particularly the leadership. And if you might remember, I had said that Peter has something special going on that's going to happen in chapter 10 of Acts, and Peter needed to be validated. So I believe 3 is going on to play, as well as number 2. We might have ourselves a hybrid here. Wouldn't that be fun? More than one category of play at the same time? Heaven forbid. God be so complex. And the last category, number 4, Acts chapter 2, verse 22, this is kind of based off of, not all by itself, but just as an example, to validate Jesus as the Messiah. So that people know that it's Jesus. What was it that Peter referred to when he was healing the paralyzed man? Jesus heals you. I am not a great apostle who points to Jesus, Peter's basically saying. He's saying, I'm an apostle who's pointing to a great Jesus. And yes, there's a difference. There's a big difference. So Peter's pointing to a great Jesus, okay? And so he's saying, Jesus does this. Jesus heals you. In the name of Jesus, this is happening, okay? So that is kind of that attitude there. Now, from that, let's go back now to Stephen and Tabitha. Let's unpack this just a little bit. Tabitha was raised from the dead because, one, we know that people came to know Jesus as Savior. Two, we also know that Peter had to be validated because he's about to change the dietary laws from a vision after Cornelius summons him in Acts chapter 10. And you need to have validation if you're going to do something that drastic. That's a big change. That's going to forever alter the life of the Jews. Even today, Jews don't grasp Peter's vision. Think about that. Nearly 2,000 years later, and Jews are still confused over Acts 10. Okay, I even know Christian Jews who are confused over Acts 10. And if we have a group of Christian Jews here in Grand Rapids that I personally attended worship with services with them before. And I talked with the head rabbi, and we're chatting for a while, and he believes in Jesus as the Messiah. They're fully about the New Testament, and they're still in complete dietary law. And they say that, no, Peter's vision, that wasn't to the Jews at all. That was just to Gentile people. And they completely misread what's all going on there. So this whole thing about Peter is still an issue. Even with all the validation in play. I wonder what it would have been like if it wasn't validated. If all we had was Peter putting his foot in his mouth and sinking in the water, and then suddenly he says, oh, by the way, change everything. You think people might have been a little skeptical whether that belonged in the canon of Scripture? Just wondering. Okay, so that's going on, as well as validating Jesus there. But what about Stephen? Stephen's unique here. He wasn't raised from the dead. God did not intervene, did not stop that from happening. Some people say, well, that's because Saul wouldn't have become Paul if that were the case. I don't think that's necessarily true. I think if Saul stood there and watched somebody get stoned, and all of a sudden they're dead and they begin to leave, and Stephen stands up and goes, hey, guys, you really ought to put your shoulder into that throw if you're going to do this right. I think Saul would have went, what? And then Stephen started saying, hey, I saw Jesus, and you just killed his messenger. I'm telling you, I'm raised from the dead because of Jesus. Saul, I believe, would have converted. I think that would have gotten his attention. Or why didn't God just appear to Saul in that blinding thing that Saul had before the rocks were thrown? Why not just do the Damascus Road, not on Damascus? Why not do it there before Stephen died? Okay, so there's something else going on there. And I think it all boils down to something that we talked about back when we talked about Stephen's martyrdom that needs to be refreshed and re-brought about, and that is what happened after Stephen died. Saul went on a murderous rampage, and the church scattered. Scattered everywhere. They went into Judea, they went into Samaria, and they went to the ends of the earth. What was it they were not doing before? The church was localized in Jerusalem only, operating in Israel only, and Jesus had said, "Be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." They weren't doing it. Now, this does not mean that God wanted Stephen to die and that God brought about plans to make sure Stephen died. That is not what happened. God does not cause evil. He is not the author of evil. God does use evil. He does use it and allows it. And through maintaining, not intervening, brings about his will with that evil as part of that plan. Okay, it's kind of like when you look at a mirror and you go to strike it with a hammer. I almost did this today because I thought it would be fun. And here's what it would have looked like. Okay, it was going to be a mess. And it was going to be just, I wasn't going to do it. It could also be dangerous. But here's what I would do. I would actually have a mirror, and I would have somebody have a black marker and predict, if I struck right here and draw, I would draw a circle, and then predict how the cracks were going to break. And then I struck the mirror. Do you think that the mirror would break just on those lines? We can't predict the randomness of the break. Sometimes when glass breaks, it just shatters into bitty little useless pieces. Sometimes glass breaks in such a way that you can hold it and it becomes a weapon. Sometimes glass breaks and it's still usable for other purposes. Sometimes you can use the pieces of the mirror to make a collage or to make some type of artwork that's gorgeous. Sometimes you just throw it away. You see, evil is random like that. And what God does is he figures out how to, he works with it. He's, okay, here comes this random thing, but it's not outside of his control. And then he's able to say, okay, this just shattered. But that's okay. We got artwork. We got weapons. We got a lot of things we're going to do with this. And this is going to be all part of his plan. And so Stephen is going to be killed. And God goes, okay, here's this random evil that's happening. Stephen's going to be killed. Could intervene and stop it. But better yet, I'm going to go ahead and maintain status quo. I'm going to allow it to happen, and then I'm going to use it so that people will be saved all over the world. That in the attempt to silence God's people, the voice becomes stronger. Isn't that a paradox? And that's what God does. In the attempt to silence, God screams louder. I love the fact, that's where I love the book Revelation. It's my favorite book, not because it's about prophecy and end times and all that. It's because to me, it's a book of divine defiance to where they're killing all the apostles of God. They're killing every single apostle. They tried killing John. It did not work. It freaked them out because God intervened to allow John to live. They tried boiling him alive in oil, and he survived it. And so they freaked out and said, we got to silence this man of God. We can't kill him, so let's just shove him on an island somewhere where nobody can hear from him again. So they exiled him to an island, took all the boats off and left, and still the letter of Revelation came off that island to the seven churches. And still God showed up and something happened, and God's voice is not squelched because of the intentions of feeble man. I love Revelation because of its defiance nature. We're going to silence the apostles, and yet a letter still comes out of there. Still, the word of God is revealed and spread across the world. It's awesome. It's awesome. Okay, so that's what God does. He does that. So why did Stephen die? So that the church would do the mission it was sent to do. That's why the first thing that happens is the church spread to Samaria. And then they ran across an Ethiopian who the Romans called the ends of the earth. So the mission, in a sense, metaphorically completed, but still exists to this day. To continue sending the gospel across the globe. And a voice that cannot be silenced. Not even a little bit. But then that brings us to one last final issue. And that is that there is actually hope in this. Because God does not intervene always, we can understand the answer to this question. Because of Genesis chapter 3, there is existence of sin that corrupts and twists all of creation. That sometimes there are diseases and deformities and birth defects, and we grow old, our bodies fall apart, and we will one day die as part of the curse of sin. There is also the existence of personal sin, like in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 30, where people just metaphorically spit in the face of God, and then one day they find themselves falling asleep. That sometimes our suffering is because of our own personal sin. You drive drunk, you get in a wreck, and you're paralyzed as a result of your own personal sin. Okay, so sometimes our suffering and our infirmities are because of our own issues of sin. And sometimes it's just because we live in a fallen, twisted world. But what we do know is that regardless of what you're dealing with in both cases, personal infected sin or whether it's because of a sinful, fallen, twisted world, we know that there is hope for all suffering. Because I had said that God does not always intervene in between the trees. But what happens on that second example, that second bookend of the tree called the new earth? It says this in Revelation 21, 3 and 4, as John is hearing that the new earth is formed. In verses 1 and 2, I saw a new heaven and a new earth. And then he says this, and I heard a loud voice from the throne. Look, God's dwelling is with humanity. It's neat to know that God will walk with us. You don't spend eternity in heaven in some bodiless spirit thing floating around with a harp and a halo. We live on earth in a resurrected body, and God is with us. It's never us with God. Always God with us. Always Emmanuel. Always Emmanuel. It's his name. It's his identity. God with us. So God will dwell on the new earth physically with us. So God is dwelling with humanity. He will live with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them. You see that? Wherever we got up with that heaven by and by forever in the pie in the sky thing is just beyond me. That's more Plato than Bible. Okay, so God is with them and be their God. He will what? Wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will no longer exist. Grief, crying, pain will exist no longer because the previous things have passed away. In other words, that time will come on that new earth, the other side of everlasting, the other side of God's kingdom there, the other side of eternity, all suffering will be dealt with. All of it will be. Let me just give you a glimpse of what this looks like. Yesterday, this has happened a couple times, but yesterday it happened again. My daughter and my whole family was at a family reunion. And I'm playing catch with my brother-in-law and with his son. We're having a good time. And my son's running around eating bubbles. And I kid you not, long story. And my daughter's trying to catch the bubbles that are, I think, coming out of his mouth as he coughs. I don't know. But so she's catching bubbles. He's eating bubbles. He just tried downing it. And all of a sudden, I'm throwing a ball. All of a sudden, I hear this like splut noise, you know, some type of an impact noise. And of all the sounds, a dad knows when his child cries. I don't care what noise is going on around you, a dad knows when a child cries. I can hear George or Ziva cry at any point. When I hear them cry, I know they're crying. When I'm in a crowd like that, I hear it. I hear it over the noise. I hear this impact noise, and I hear my daughter start to cry. And immediately I looked over, and I saw her on the ground holding her knee. She had fallen and scraped up her knee. And she's just laying on the ground holding her knee. And immediately I told my brother-in-law, you guys keep playing. Took my glove off, did the unforgivable sin in baseball, and threw my glove on the ground. And I took off toward my daughter. Okay, and I'm going toward her. And she's trying to get up, and she's doing this. And she's holding her knee, and she's just weeping and weeping. I open up my arms to her. I said, come here, come to me. And I'm running to her, and she's just doing this, and she reaches one hand out to me, and I scoop her up into my arms, and I come over, and I just kind of sit down on the edge of the picnic table, and I got her in my arms, and she has these big, fat crocodile tears running down her face, and she's just crying, and she lays her head right here into my chest and into my arm, and I just kind of stroke her hair a little bit, and I wipe the tears from her face, and I tell her, it's okay, Daddy's got you. Daddy's got you. I'm right here. And I'm just holding her close. This is what God's going to do to all of our suffering. We're going to be before him. We're going to have all the knowledge of all the pain and everything that once was, all the suffering we've gone through. He's going to, everything that our full life has dealt with, every piece of arthritis, every loss of a loved one, every pain, every suffering, every act. One day, God is going to be reaching out his arms. He's going to scoop us up, put our head on his chest, and with his thumb, he's going to wipe away the tear and say, "It's all right, Daddy's got you. Daddy's got you." There is hope for all suffering. For all suffering. If God's not intervening now, he will someday when he wipes that tear away from your eye. And everything you're dealing with will be over. There is hope in this. This is why Paul said in Thessalonians, encourage one another with these words. That everything you're dealing with is temporary. It's temporary. It will not last forever. It might last this life. But it will not last forever. And God will wipe away that tear. That is the hope in our suffering. And that type of hope, by the way, shakes this world on its very core. Because this world says death is natural. This world believes a lie that says that suffering is just a way of life and that's what is. But the Christian knows it's not natural. The Christian knows that something's wrong with death. We know why it hurts. Why it's out of place, why everything's broken. And when the world becomes confused, the Christian can have hope. And that shakes the world, the very foundation of their understanding of life. And that's the beginning of the gospel. How are you going to let your life show hope in your suffering? Not point out the hope in others, but the hope in your suffering. Let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father,